Okay, well, welcome everyone. So I'm sorry if this room is not perfect for so many people, but I thought that it would be better to have tables instead of just nothing, like in the seminar room. So let's see how it works. If it is too many people, tomorrow we'll try to find something else. But for the moment, I hope it works more or less. Okay, well, so this is basically a 1 week course. So in advance, I tell you that I'm not going to be explaining all the details about everything, but this is just supposed to be an introduction to some tools. Some of them are very used, very much used in the community. So you will find many people working on them. Some of them way, way, way more expert than me. So if you have any questions, you can ask me, but I can also say I don't know. Try to convey this question to someone else. So the idea is to have some basic knowledge about some. The idea is to have some basic knowledge about some computer tools which are basically used for physics beyond the standard model. So people doing model building, phenomenology, beyond the standard model will find this course very useful. And basically I would like to begin with a piece of history, which is basically this letter, which you probably know already. This is a letter that was written by Pauli to some people that were in a conference in Tübingen in 1930, and this is the famous letter where he proposed the existence of the neutrino. And I have a translation in English because I don't have any German. So, well, basically the idea is that he was trying to explain, as you know, the spectrum of the beta decay, where it was observed that it was a continuous spectrum instead of a fixed energy for the electrons. And this was a problem at the time because they didn't observe anything else. They needed an explanation for this, and he came up with this idea that maybe there is a new particle that is also being produced in this decay, and this new particle we don't observe, and it's carrying out some energy, and this is the explanation. And what I find funny about this letter is that he writes this like almost apologizing about this explanation. He says that this is a desperate remedy because he wants to save the conservation of energy and momentum. Also, he says that he doesn't dare to publish anything about this idea, because he's proposing a new particle that we didn't observe. This is, at that time, this was kind of outrageous. How could you do that? To propose a new particle that you didn't observe. And I find this funny because nowadays we do exactly the opposite. So every day we have new models on the archive with new particles, new symmetries, and many new things. And I find it funny that at that time this was considered like almost a Scientology, or I don't know, some kind of belief. And now we find it normal. So we propose new particles, new models, and we are happy with that. And the thing is that with this explosion of new models, there are many things you have to do every time you get a new model. You have to calculate analytically the masses of the new particles, the new interactions. You have to calculate, for example, what is the structure of the scalar potential. You have to minimize it to find the minimum of the potential, to calculate also what are the normalization group equations to see how the parameters evolve with energy. Or you may be interested also in numerical routines, because in the end you want to do some calculations that you cannot do analytically, so you also have to do some programming with some codes. Then you also have to include corrections, you have to calculate observables, you may be interested in dark matter, in collider simulation. So in the end, every time you get a new model, and now we have thousands of models, I could say, you have a lot of work to do. And this was done traditionally, basically like this. No? So this is basically the traditional way to do particle physics. So you have a professor and you have a student. The student does everything. The professor says compute, 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 and in the end, the work is done. But the point is that there are many things that are done always in the same way. So you just basically repeat a process. For example, when you calculate mass matrices, you know that you have to first, for example, take some derivatives of the potential. Then you put them properly in a matrix, and then basically that's what you have. So why not automatizing this process? This is the whole idea of this course. There are some things that can be done always in the same way, and for that we have computers, so we don't have to do it by hand anymore. Now, there are four tools I will be speaking about. The first two that will be hopefully for today, if not today and tomorrow, are SARA and Sfino. I will tell you much more about them later. Basically, SARA is the package or the code that we'll be using to get analytical information about models. And Sfino is the tool that we will be using to get numerical information about models. They combine together to get both analytical and numerical information. Then we will also learn something about Micromega, which is a very popular code for calculations related to dark matter, and MatGraph, which is also a very popular code for collider simulations. So these are basically the four tools we will be working with basically most of the time. As I said, these are some of them, for example, MatGraph or Micromega, are so much used in the community that there are already very good manuals, very good even websites where you can ask questions, so on the internet. And then anything I could say is already written somewhere. So you can get a lot of information just by Googling MatGraph, Micromegas. So this is just supposed to be an introduction to these tools. You have plenty of information to explore, to expand. There are some messages I wanted to tell you before I begin. The first one is that some people think, oh yes, yes, there are tools, but they are very hard to use. So they are scared to learn. And so people think that basically these codes are like this. So what I'm trying to tell you with this course is that they are actually like this. It's really, really simple to start using these tools. Really simple. You just need to basically spend a few hours and you are already almost an expert on them. At least with Sara and Stino, which are very simple. So this is kind of a positive message. Eh? Don't worry too much. This is really easy, at least at the level that we are aiming at. And the second message, which is negative, is okay, but do not trust too much in codes, because they can get they can have errors, they can have bugs, and if you trust too much in codes, you will be making mistakes, stupid mistakes, all the time. So be very careful with codes. Always be critical with the results. Try to see if they make sense, because sometimes you get a math which is huge and you didn't expect that, or tiny and you didn't expect that. So be critical with the result, because otherwise you will be making very embarrassing mistakes sometimes. Okay? These are the two messages before I start. And this is basically the plan. So there are 5 days or 5 lectures. The first one will be based on Sara, and it's gonna be like the center of everything. Sara will be the tool that we will use to produce input for the other tools. So this lecture is kind of the most important one. And that's why this one will be in principle a bit longer. So please stop me if I take too much time, but I hope not to be taking more than an hour and a half of your lives. Okay? So this is the idea, an hour and a half today. And the rest are shorter, and then in principle in 1 hour each, it should be okay. The last day is kind of experimental. I don't know how it will go, but basically the course is mainly focused on the 4 lectures that we have until Thursday. Last day will be like a final exercise, repeating everything we did, but a bit more carefully. And then in the last day, we will have time for questions, discussion. If you have any question, okay, I tried to do this, it didn't work in my laptop. Okay, you tell me, and then we try to do it together. And also, if we have time, depending on your questions, I will also briefly mention a different tool, which is called Flavor Kit. But let's see, that will depend on time and your questions. And finally, these are the references that I will be using. Mainly, I will be using these notes that you can find on archive. You can download them. And basically, the idea is that you don't have to take notes of anything. I mean, all the commands, the routines, everything we will be using are explained here. Like very clearly, and you don't have to write anything down. Everything will be covered here. In this course, I will be using non-supersymmetric models as examples. If you want to do something with supersymmetry, you can do it. And there are a few little details which are different, but just a few. And for that, I recommend this reference, which is basically parallel to this one, but with supersymmetry. So if you want to do something specific to supersymmetry, this one is really helpful. Also, this one covers some details that I don't cover so much. So if you want to discuss, to study this one, it's also helpful. There are also, of course, the manuals. So of course, every code has a manual, and they are published, so you can read them. And I created this website. Some of the files that I will be using are already there. So I recommend to download them before the lectures, or during the lectures, if you want, you can download them now. Because that way you don't have to write down anything and you can already run with the files that I provide here. And also there is some additional information about the website for the different manuals and everything. So I recommend you have a look at this website. Now, this is already the final slide of the introduction. So these are basically the rules. You can interrupt, ask questions, comments. As I said, some of the questions could be, I don't know, this could be the answer, because I'm not the author of these tools, so there may be some details that I don't know, but I will try to help you, or if I don't know, I can try to contact these people. And you can emulate what I do with your laptop, but this is not mandatory, you can just observe. I will do everything I do, I will do it live. So I will compile, run, everything here. That will mean that at some point maybe you have to wait 1 minute until something finishes, but that's it, okay? This is the problem, but at least you can see how everything is done in practice. And you can do it at the same time if you want. I mean, you will have time. And also, okay, this is important. I will assume that you have already installed everything you will need. This means Mathematica, C++ and Fortran compilers, and then maybe LaTeX compiler, and that's it. Basically, that's all you need. It's not possible to answer specific questions about, it's not working in my laptop, can you help me? Because otherwise I would have to stop, like, you know, every 5 minutes, and this is not, this cannot work. But, so I assume that you try to do it by yourself. If you have a problem, of course I can try to help, but if this is, it doesn't compile in my laptop and I'm doing what you did. Okay, maybe you need a library or whatever, this I cannot help. So I assume that you already have everything. Okay, and then, so if there are no questions, no comments, I start with lecture one. Okay, so let's move on. Okay, so I close this one. Okay, so this is lecture one. As I said, this will be based on Sara and Sino. Hopefully 1.5 hours. If it takes more time, then I will stop and I continue tomorrow with the last part. Okay, so let's start with Sara. Okay, Sara is a Mathematica package. Okay, so you don't need to compile anything. You just have to load it in Mathematica. It's written by Florian Stahl, which is now at CERN. You can ask him questions. He's very active in the net. I mean, you have questions, whatever, he replies emails, he's very active, also because he wants to, you know, promote his code, he's very helpful. And you can find everything here. The last version is 4.6, I think, and it's the one that I'm going to use for this course. They don't change much between one version and the next one, so you can take whatever you want. But try to take one of the latest, because otherwise there may be some little details which are different. So what does Sara do? So Sara is, as I said, it's a tool for analytical derivation. Basically, the basic idea is that you put your model in Sara, you define the model, say, okay, this is my model, these are my particles, and this is my Lagrangian. And then Sara does a lot of things for you. For example, it calculates the Lagrangian. Basically, you don't have to specify everything. You specify some quantum charges, some Yukawas, and then Sara calculates everything for you. It calculates all the mass matrices for scalars, fermions, vectors in your model. It calculates all the vertices. So, I don't know, all Yukawa vertices, all interactions, analytically. It calculates the tadpole equations to minimize the potential. Also, loop corrections to the tadpoles and to the self energies. The normalization group equations at the two loop level. As you probably know, if you ever tried to calculate this, this is really a lot of work, like years calculating sometimes. So Sara does it for you. Also calculates flavor observables, like mu to e gamma, and things like that. And it also, and this is super important, I mean, already with this, it would be already very useful, but with this, the last step is really nice. It also creates input files for other codes. The idea is that once all this information is in Sara, Sara can also create input files, for example, for Micromegas. So you don't need to write by hand input files for the other codes. And this is very nice and very useful for this course, because I will base everything on the implementation in Sara. Every time I want to do something with Micromegas or MatchGraph, the first thing I will do is to implement the model in Sara. I will create the input for that code, and then I will use it. And then that way you don't have any possibility for mistakes, because typing by hand input files for Micromegas is really nasty, and it's very likely that you will make a mistake. So Sara does it for you. Okay, there are already many models implemented in Sara. This means that if you want to use any of these models, you can already load Sara, you load the model, and you start getting results. You don't need to do anything else. What I will show you now is how to implement a new model, because this is what probably you will need at some point. You want to study a new model, and then you will have to implement the model. So this is the first step. But if you just want to use one of these models, then you don't need to do that. You just load the model and you get analytical results, numerical results, anything. And you see, originally SARA was designed for supersymmetric models, so that's why there are so many SUSY models. But after version 3, I think, there is also the possibility of using non-supersymmetric models in SARA. And there are a few, the standard model, but also some other models which are less minimal. Also, there are some private models that you can get by contacting some people because they have an implementation and you can contact them. If they are nice, they will give it to you. But this is basically the idea. So as I said, if you want to use any of those models, you don't need to implement anything. You just load the model and you say, okay, give me the information. Just give me everything. You don't have to do anything. But the first thing we will learn is how to implement a model, because this is basically what you will probably need at some point, no? If you want to study any model. And this is going to be the scotogenic model. But before I do that, let me show you how to use SARA, how to load it, and so on. So now I sit down and I show you with my laptop. Okay, so if you have been, if you have gone to the website, so this is the website we created for the course, and you see that there are two files that you can download. This one is Ramsar Scotogenic and Scotogenic, okay? And there are also some links on the right where you can find the different tools we are going to use. For example, SARA is here. Okay, this is the website for SARA, and you can download the code here. So I will be using this one, 4.6. Okay, I downloaded it already, so I have it here in, okay, let me find, in codes. I have these files already downloaded. So the file for SARA, and these two files which we will use later. So the first thing is to unpack the files. So this is a tar.gc, so this is done simply with tar minus xf and then the name of the file. This is a normal command to untar files. So here you have it, this is a new folder. We can go inside to see what we have. Okay, there are several subfolders, and as you can see there is one which is called models. Okay, this is where you can find all the models that are already implemented in SARA. For example, the standard model is here, the same. There is also a model with a standard model plus a color object. There are models like the NMSSM, the MSSM. There are many models. So here is where you have all the models in SARA. Okay, now let me show you how to use it. Okay, so let me open this file that I created for you, this Ramsar Scotogenic. This is Mathematica. Okay. To run SARA, you just have to load the package as any Mathematica package. So you say something like this, get, and then you point to the package file. Nothing else. You just see. And SARA, in a laptop much faster than mine, this would be faster, but okay. And that's it. We have loaded SARA. So that's simple. You don't need to compile anything. You don't need to do anything really complicated. The next step would be to load the model you want to use. So for this course, we will start using this scotogenic model that I will explain now in a moment. And this is done with start and the name of the model. That's simple. Okay? But before I do that, let me explain the model. So any questions so far? I think this is super clear, no? This is very simple. Okay. So, the scotogenic model. I mean, this is going to be a course about tools, not about physics. So, I will just give a very, very, very brief introduction to this model with just the basic details you need to know, and that's it. So, if you have questions, we can try to discuss, but the main idea is not to discuss the model, but how to implement the model in SARA. Okay, maybe you know this model by other names. In the literature, sometimes it is called the radiative CISO, mass model, the inner doublet model. I don't like any of those. I like the scotogenic, because also it's also more original. And this is basically the model. It's a very simple model. You have the standard model plus two new guys. This guy M, which is a singlet under the standard model gauge group. and a scalar doublet, and this is a fermion, sorry, I didn't say. And this doublet eta is a doublet under raised to left with hyperchar minus 1/2. So exactly the same quantum charges as this, the Higgs doublet of the standard model. In addition to the standard model gate symmetry, you have a new symmetry, a Z2, a discrete symmetry, under which all the fields in the standard model have a plus charge, and the two new fields have charge minus. And that's it. That is the definition of the model. I mean, it's very simple. Standard model plus two new eyes, which are this right-handed neutrino, you may call, and a new doublet, which is odd under a new symmetry. That's it. The name scotogenic, as you will see in a moment, has to do with the fact that in this model you have dark matter. And scotos in Greek means darkness. So Ernest Mach, who was the proposer of this model, thought that this was a nice name for the model. In Greek. Okay, fine. This is the idea of the model. Okay, so you have, basically this is the Lagrangian of the model. These are the terms which are related to the new singlets. So you have the kinetic term. You can write down a Majorana mass for this field, because it's singlet, so you don't break any charge. And there is a Yukawa between the leptons and these new singlets with this eta field. Okay? You cannot write down a Yukawa with the normal Higgs because of this Z2 symmetry. The Z2 forbids that couple. This is the definition of basically the model. And this is the scalar potential. So you have this phi field, which is the Higgs doublet of the standard model. You have the eta field, and you have terms which combine them, like this lambda 3, lambda 4, and lambda 5. Okay, this is the definition of the model. So I copy here again the potential. This is just a copy of the previous formula. And the thing is that in the scalar sector, in the inner scalar sector, so regarding the eta, typically you split the fields that you have in the doublet in this way. So you have a charged guy, like in the standard model charged guy, and you have a neutral one. And the neutral one can be split into real and imaginary parts in the usual way. And if you do that, you can calculate, and we will show it later, that the masses get an expression like this. So the charged guy gets a mass which is proportional to the bell of the Higgs, and it has an additional term, which is this m eta squared, which is nothing but this one. And then the real and imaginary parts of the neutral guy basically get a different expression, but that's it. And well, it's remarkable that the difference between this guy and this guy is just given by lambda 5. But this is just, I mean, all these things you just have to basically believe. I mean, I'm not showing any results for you to calculate now. It's just, I mean, this is the model. Now, the model is also interesting because it provides neutrino masses at the one loop level. Since the charged leptons do not couple directly to the Higgs, because you have this Z2 symmetry, the field that appears here is eta, not the Higgs. And this eta doesn't have a BEV by definition. Because of that, you don't get neutrino masses at the tree level, but you get them eventually at the loop level, in a diagram like this. So you have your neutrinos here, you have the singlets and the eta fields running in the loop, and then once you put these BEVs, this is the famous lambda 5 coupling that I told you about before, you get basically neutrino masses. So this is an idea that now has become very fashionable, because you have dark particles, and you will see that later, running in the loop. And there are many models exploring this idea in more complicated ways. But the funny thing is that you have these guys, which could be dark matter, running in the loop that provides masses to neutrinos. This is the motivation for this model. And dark matter, as I said. So you have a Z2 symmetry that, by assumption, is not broken by anything. So the particle which is lightest and has a minus under this Z2 symmetry is a stable candidate for dark matter. And there are two possibilities, either the right-handed neutrino, the singlets, or the lightest of the eta guys. So you have two choices here. If you have the right-handed neutrino, this has been explored, not so much, but this has been explored. But with the scalars, there are already probably more than 20 or 30 papers. So this has been discussed very much in the literature. And that's why this model is kind of very fashionable nowadays, because you can have neutrino masses, dark matter, more or less in a simple way. You just need a few more ingredients beyond the standard mode. It's not very complicated. Okay, so with this I explain everything I wanted to say about the model. If you have questions or comments, you are very welcome. Okay, so now I will show you how to implement this model in SARA to get results. And for that, I will sit down again. Okay, and let's go back to SARA. Okay, once it is implemented, it is already, but I will show you what I did. We just have to click here in Start Chondogenic and we will get the results. And let me show you, this I can close, and this I can close. Yes. Let me show you what you need to do to implement a model. Okay, so there are basically four files every time you need to implement a model. So let me go to SARA, as I did before, codes, SARA. Okay, this is the folder in SARA. And then let's go to models. Every time you want to create a model, this is my personal recommendation. You can do it from scratch. You open a text file and you start writing the definition of your model. But if you do that, you will probably miss a bracket or you will miss something. So my recommendation is every time you want to implement a model, copy the standard model and then add the new elements. Because you will always have the standard model in the end. So unless you are doing something which is not realistic. Okay, but you can do it, of course, if you want to play. But the thing is that I did it myself many times. I tried to do something from scratch and I made many mistakes. So my recommendation is never do that. Copy a standard model and then modify, add new ingredients, because otherwise you will make a mistake. Okay, and in the website you have this file. Let me open another. You have this file, Chondogenic tar GZ. Okay. Which is the implementation of the model. So I will show you what I did. So first, I unstar it. Okay, we have the new folder. And this folder has to be moved inside SARA, so in the models folder. So I move it to SARA, models. Okay, so now it should appear here. Yes, it's called again. Let's go inside to see what we have. And we have basically, well, there are several files, there are five files in this moment. Some of them are optional, so I will explain them one by one. I will start with the main file, which is the one called chondogenic.m. Okay, this is the main file. This is an M file, so you can open it with Mathematica. I personally prefer to use Emacs or, you know, a text editor because it's simpler. You don't need to open Mathematica, it's just text. I use Emacs, but also this is optional. You can use whatever you want. And let me make it bigger. I think it's, yeah. You can see it properly, right? Okay. Thank you. Okay, so this is basically the main file. I will now explain what is written here. So this is where we define the model. Okay? So there are several steps you have to follow. The first thing you have to do is you have to give a name to the model. In this case, it's chondogenic. Okay. This is whatever you want. Then you can use a longer name, like a more elegant if you want. This is the one that is going to be used for internal reference, and this is the one that is going to be used for presentation. You will see later that one thing that SARA can do for you is to create some LaTeX file with the information of your model. So this is the name that will appear in the nice LaTeX file that you get with your model. Then these are the authors, Nicolas is here, and this is the day when we did the model, so the model date. Now you can add as many comments as you want. This is like Mathematica. In Mathematica, comments are, you know, bracket, asterisk, bracket. So these are comments, and this is of course optional. Comments are for you. Okay? You write something and then you probably 1 year, why did I do that? Then comments are useful for that. And then this is the physics. So the first thing you have to do is to tell SARA about the symmetries of the model. So first, for example, let's start with the global symmetry. As I said, in addition to the standard model gauge group, the chondogenic model has this set to symmetry. And this is defined here. So for each symmetry you have, for each global symmetry, you have this global and then number. And you have a list. In this model there is only one, so I only have global one. And then I have to specify first what is the type of symmetry, Z2. And then second, I have to give a name to the symmetry. And I'm super original and it's Z2. Okay? That's it. I have defined that I have a global symmetry of a Z2 type in this model. Next, I have to explain what are the gate symmetries in the model. This is a bit longer. In this case, we have three gate symmetries: U1, SU2, and SU3, the standard model symmetries. And then for each one of them, I have to give several details. First, I have to say what is the name of the Gauge boson. For example, for U1, the Gauge boson is going to be called B, the standard notation, the B boson. Then you have to say what is the Gauge group, U1. Then you have to give a name to the group, in this case, hypercharge. You have to give a name to the coupling, to the Gauge coupling, G1. And then the last thing, or the one before the last, you have to choose between true or false. This is basically, you are telling Sarah whether you want to expand or not in gauge indices. So let me explain. As you know, in SU2, for example, in the lepton doublet, you have the neutrinos and the charged leptons. And usually, when you write down the Lagrangian, after symmetry breaking, you want to see the charged leptons on one side and the neutrinos on the other. You want to see them split. So that's why in SU2 we say true. We want to expand gauge indices and see the elements in the multiplets separately. Okay? For U1 this doesn't make sense because U1 doesn't have different elements in the multiplet. For SU3 you could do that. You could say, okay, I have an octet. I want to see the 8 elements of the octet split in the Lagrangian. But usually you don't want to do that because SU3 is not broken. So these elements are always combined together. So that's why we choose, this is a choice, to say false. We don't want to expand in SU3. Okay? And the last entry is because we have a global symmetry. If we didn't have a global symmetry, this is the end. If not, like this case, we have to say whether these gauge bosons are charged or not under the global symmetry. Since they are not charged, we just say plus one for the three of them. Okay, and you see that we repeated exactly the same for the second gauge group, for SU2, and for the third one, for SU3. So for SU2, for example, we said that we want to call the gauge boson WB. This is a choice. That the gauge coupling will be G2, and so on. And we will call it left. And then the third one is color, G3, and the gluons are called capital G. Okay, and we are done with the symmetries. The symmetries is specified. Now we have to start with the matter fields, so fermions and scalars. For this, we have two different commands, let's say, fermion fields and scalar fields. And for each multiplet that you have to use a different row. And we have here all the multiplets in the scotogenic model. So we have quarks, leptons, right-handed quarks, right-handed leptons. For example, let's consider the first one. For this, I made a slide, which is, I think, more clear. This is basically what we have in the first line. So we have fermion field 1. This is the name of the multiplet. So Q is the name of the multiplet. We specify that we have three generations of this multiplet, because we have three quark doublets in the scotogenic model. Then, you cannot see it here. Maybe let me go back for a moment. For some reason, you cannot see that there is a bracket here. Anyway, so here you have to specify, since this is going to be a doublet at the SU2, you have to specify the name for each element of the doublet. So the up quark and the down quark, it's specified here. If instead of a doublet you have something else, you will see that you have to do something basically the same. You have to specify a name for each element of the doublet, or the triplet, or whatever you have. And then you have to give the charges under each symmetry that you have defined before. So under U1 hypercharge, this guy has an hypercharge of 1 over 6. This is a doublet under SU2 left, and this is a triplet under SU3 color. And finally, this has plus 1 under the Z2 of the model. So this is how you define a multiplet. So you say, this is the name of the multiplet, I have this many generations, these are the names of the elements, and these are the charges. And that's it. And you have defined a multiplet. and you would have to do basically the same for the others. So for example, this is basically the same in the second row, but with the lepton doublet. So you have, you call it L, you define three generations, VL, EL are the elements of the doublet, so this is the left-handed neutrino, and this is the left-handed sublepton. You say that it has hypercharge minus 1/2, that it's a doublet and there is U2, that it's a singlet and there is U3, and that it's a singlet also, plus 1, under the Z2 symmetry. And you repeat exactly the same for the other fields. For example, for the right-handed fields, okay, there is a little subtlety that you need to know. As I told you already, this SARA is based. Originally, the idea was to do it only for supersymmetric models. And you know that when you write down the superpotential in supersymmetry, all the fields that appear have to be left-handed. Okay, and this is kind of reflected here. Again, all the fermion fields here have to be left-handed. So for example, the right-handed quark of type D, you don't call it DR, but you call it conjugate of DR. So it's the left-handed version of the DR field. Okay, but that's just a little detail. Okay, for the right-handed fields, you always have to use this conjugate to make it left, but that's it. Okay, and the hypercharge, this is singlet of SU2. Since this is a conjugate, it's a minus 3 of SU3. It's a 3 bar, if you want, with a charge plus 1 under the Z2. And basically, we repeat the same for the other fields. You can see, for example, that the only fields that have a minus 1 in the last entry are this N and this ET, which are the right-handed neutrinos and the eta doublet that I defined here, basically. These guys here. And the only ones with a minus in the set to symmetry. And this is what we have. And that's it. So we have defined all the fields in the model, scalar and fermion. So I continue. Okay, usually this line you never have to modify it. Okay? Basically, in this line you define two sets of states or two bases. You define what we would call basically the gauge basis and the mass basis. Okay? And then later you define properties of each of them. But usually you never have to modify this line. In some models you may be interested in some intermediate basis. Like before I totally diagonalize my model, I want some intermediate basis where, I don't know, some flavor symmetry is more crystal clear or whatever. In that case you may define additional basis. But most of the time, I would say 99% of times, you just have the gauge basis and the mass basis. So you don't have to modify this line. Okay, next to define the Lagrangian of the model. And this is done here. Again, here you have a lot of freedom. So I personally like to split my Lagrangian in many terms so that I remember later what is the meaning of each term. But you can also say, my Lagrangian is this, and you put all the terms together. So what I did here is to split the Lagrangian in six terms. And you never have to define the kinetic terms. The kinetic terms are supposed to be canonical, so you don't have to specify. You just have to specify the Yukawa couplings and the potential terms. That's it. For example, the first line, this lag fair, is basically the Yukawas. So you have this YD, and then you have H dagger, D cube. So this is the D quark Yukawa coupling. You have the same for the chaplettons, for the up type quarks, and the new Yukawa coupling that you have with this eta and n that you saw previously on the slides. Okay? So this line is basically this. Okay? Lag fair is exactly this. So each of these terms is reflected here. Okay? So that's the Yukawa coupling. Then I have also this additional term, which is this lag NV, okay, which is nothing but NN and MN divided by 2. So this is basically this this term here. It's the Majorana mass for these singlets, that typically you put 1 over 2. This is a convention. Then I have a Lagrangian for the H field, so for the standard model Higgs. So I have this MH squared, H dagger H, plus 1 over 2, lambda 1, it's a, I mean, I'm defining the different terms in the potential. Notice that you always have to use this dot between the fields. This is to tell Sarah do the correct gauge contractions. So you don't have to specify how to contract doublets or doublets with triplets or whatever. The rules of the contraction are known by Sarah, but you have to say contract, and this contract is this dot. So remember to use the dot, otherwise you will get very funny mistakes, like a violation of electric charge or things like that. So you have to contract properly, and this is done with these dots. Then you have these other fields. I mean, this is basically for you to have a look, but it's basically repeating the different terms in this notation. And once you have done that, you have to define, and this is done here. You can do it before, not a problem. For each term that you have defined, you have to specify whether you have to add the Hermitian conjugate or not. You know that there are some terms which are by themselves already self-conjugate. Like H dagger H, this is self-conjugate. So you don't have to say plus Hermitian conjugate. For example, this is the case here, H dagger H. So for this part of the Lagrangian, this lag H, I say false. You don't have to add the Hermitian conjugate. But for example, for the Yukawas, you need to add the Hermitian conjugate. And this is done with this 2. So it's very intuitive. And of course, splitting the Lagrangian like this is my choice. You could say, okay, I can put this term here and nothing changes. I mean, you can combine the different terms, it's your choice. Yeah.
Can you modify the kinetic terms if you want to have mixing? And, no?
Mixing?
Like if you have multiple U1s and you want to have kinetic mixing?
In that case, yes. Yes. But it's automatically done. If you have multiple U1s, by default, it writes down the kinetic mixing.
Okay.
Okay. Questions? Otherwise, you cannot. For example, you cannot say, I want non-canonical, you know, funny forms for my kinetic terms. Okay, so we have defined already the Lagrangian. That's it. Very easy. We just have to follow the same step many times, and that's it. Okay, next thing. So now you have to define what are the mixings in the gauge sector. So you know that this W1 and W2, they mix to become the W plus and W minus. And the B boson and the W3, they mix to form the photon and the cell. This is what you do here. So you say, I want to mix my V with my WV. You put this V before, but this is just notation. The component 3, sorry, I forgot to mention that, to form the photon and the boson.
I have another question. In that Lagrangian, your co-couplings are in general complex, but you can take this lambda 5 to be real. So how is that implemented there?
There is, as you saw here, there are 5 files. There is one called parameters.m, where you can give additional information about the parameters. You can impose that a parameter is real. If you don't do that, and the parameter has to be real, then you will get that all your expression will depend on the sum of parameter plus conjugate. So in the end it's real, but if you impose it, you will get it automatically. Simplified. Okay, so this is what I was telling you. This is where you define the mixing in the gauge sector. So first line, the neutral guys. So you mix the B boson with the third component of the W boson to get the photon and the set. This is the definition. And this set is the name that you give to the matrix, to the mixing matrix. Okay, this is just a name for the mixing matrix. That will be 2x2 matrix. And in the second line, you do the same thing, but with the charge guys. So you say, I mix the W1 and the W2 to get WP plus and the conjugate of WP. And the mixing matrix is called ZW. This is the name that you give to the mixing matrix. And that's the end of the story. Okay, this is where you define the mixing. And most times, you don't have to modify this, because this is the standard model way to do it. If you have additional gauge symmetries and you have more mixings and more stuff, then you have to add it here. And you will see that in the future, in the last, in the fourth lecture. Okay, next step. You have to define how electroimmunity ranking takes place. And this is done here. This H0 and this H0 have been defined already here. Have been defined as the neutral components of the tablets, the scalar tablets. So in these lines, what you are saying is, I want to split my H0 in a BEV, an imaginary part, and a real part, with these different weights. So 1 over square root of 2, I divided by square root of 2, and 1 over square root of 2. Okay? And then you do exactly the same for the other guy, with the difference that in this case, you say, I don't want to give a BEV to this guy. And then you do it like this, 0, 0. And it's basically the same. So this is, we have done this. So we have said 8-0 is decomposed like this, and eta 0 is decomposed like this. This is what we have done in that two line, in those two lines. Okay. Yes.
How could I add a complex set for any of the fields, for instance? If I wanted, I mean.
This is a good question. You can do it. You can have complex verbs. And I don't remember how to do that, but I think you have to specify what is the face of the verb. I would have to check. I don't remember how to do that. It's a good question. Otherwise, the verb is supposed to be real. More questions? Comments? Okay, the next thing is to define what are the mixings in the scalars and in the fermions after symmetry breaking. You know that these guys, when you break the symmetry, they start getting mixed. And then you have to specify what are the different mass eigenstates that you can form with the original gauge eigenstates. And this is done in these lines. And there are two ways to do that. It depends on whether you have a Majorana fermion. Well, there are three ways. It depends on whether you have a scalar or a fermion, and in fermions, it depends on whether you have a Majorana fermion or a Dirac fermion. In this model, we don't have mixings in the scalar sector. This is a particular case because it's very simple. But we have plenty of mixings in the fermion sector. So for example, the first line specifies that the three families of this field, which are defined here, this NR is here, and there are three families. In principle, they mix. So I put them here, and they say my mass eigenstates will be called X0. So this is the name that I give to the mass eigenstates, X0. And the mixing matrix is called ZX. That's it. This is because this is a Majorana fermion. So this guy mixes with himself. It doesn't mix with anyone else. If you have to do the same, but not for a Majorana fermion, but for a Dirac fermion, then you do it like this. For example, for the charged electron, which is this line, you say, my left-handed charged leptons mix with the right-handed ones. These guys will transform to these guys with this mixing matrix. These guys will become these guys with this mixing matrix. And that's it. So you have to define the rotations for the left-handed fields and for the right-handed fields independently. Because these are Dirac fermions. And you have exactly the same for the uptake quarks, for the downtake quarks, and that's it. And this line, which I didn't mention, is basically like the previous one, but for the left-handed neutrinos. Okay? They mix among themselves, with no one else, and the mass eigenstate will be called VL, and the mixing matrix will be called VV. This is just the name you want to use for these things, for these parameters. We are about to finish. Finally, so far everything has been supposed to be bifermions, so two component fermions. So before you conclude, you have to say how to construct four component fermions out of these two component fermions. And this is done here. In principle, you would have to do it also for the gauge eigenstates, but this is not relevant because all the calculations are done with the mass eigenstates. So this you don't have to modify. But for the mass eigenstates, it's very important. So for example, I say my damp work is going to be made by this DL, which I define here, and the conjugate of the DR, which is also defined here. So I'm constructing the four component spinner by putting the DL and the DR in the four components. I do the same for the charged leptons, for the other quarks, and when this is a Majorana fermion, the four component fermion is made by using this two component fermion and it calls and the component, because this is Majorana, not Dirac. But it's always, it's basically the same notation, you just use the same field again, instead of using a different field for the four component fermion. And that's it. We are done with this file. With this you have provided all the information. Okay. Any question about the file? What we did?
When you diagonalize this kind of this gauge boson sector, for example, in the neutral sector you have assigned a photon and a Z boson. How will it understand that it will assign the zero eigenvalue to the photon and the non-zero eigenvalue to gauge boson?
Okay. By definition, I mean there are some fields which are already hard-coded inside. So the photon is hard-coded. Every time you have a matrix that you say is the gauge boson, the neutral gauge boson matrix, the vanishing eigenvalue assumes that is the photon.
Yeah,
this is hard-coded.
Yeah, but if you have a new sector, for example,
if you have a new sector, then you have to do a bit more. And I will show you this in the fourth lecture. We will have an additional U1 and more stuff, and then you will see how it works. And anything else? Questions?
Is there a library with the known symmetries that you can implement with this?
There are not so many actually. There are like SU n symmetries with n up to 5, I think. And for each symmetry, the number of representations that are already implemented is not that large. I mean, this, I mean, I know that this originally started as a project. I mean, Florian Stahl, who did this, started doing this for himself. So every time he wanted to add a representation, because he was interested in a model with that representation. And basically, it has been working like this all the time. So if you want to implement something and it's not there, you have to contact him and say, okay, I want to implement, I don't know, a 5-plate of SU2. And then he tries to do it for you. Otherwise, it's not very useful. For example, in SU2, you have, of course, the singlet, you have the doublet, you have the triplet, and I think you have the 7-plate, because I asked him to do it. Otherwise, you wouldn't have the 7-plate. Okay? In SU3, you have singlet, you have triplet, sextet, I think, and octet. And this is probably in the manual. I don't know by heart, but this is probably in the manual. Also, for global symmetries, you can have U1, you can have set 2 and set 3, I think, and nothing else, I think. So far, I mean, this grows continuously. People ask for something, he asks. Okay. So we are done with this file. Actually, this is the main file in SARA, in the model. It works already only with this file. So if you just want to do some analytical calculations like mass matrices and things like that, you are done. You can already load the model and that's it. The other files are optional. And they are only there if you want to give additional details, like the reality of a parameter. You want to say, okay, this parameter is real. Or if you want to use SARA for something bigger. For example, if you want to produce input for other codes, like Sphino, we will see later, or MatGraph, and so on, then additional details about the particles and the parameters has to be given. And for that purpose, you have these additional files. Okay, but if you just want to do analytical calculations, you are done. You don't have to do anything else. Okay?
Just another thing that pops up.
Yes, yes.
So to get that mass matrix, you have to have previous idea that what fields mix with what. Like if you have the complex couplings in your scalar theory, then you will not have a CP eigenstate or something, and you have to assign a 4 plus 4 mass matrix. So that idea you have to have previously, or SARA does it automatically.
Sure, yes, that's right. That's right. So it may be, for example, that you miss a mixing. That you say, okay, these are my fields and they mix like that. SARA doesn't tell you. The only thing is that there is a command in SARA which is check model that tries to check some of these things, but it doesn't work all the time. Sometimes there might be some additional mixing that you should have written, you forgot, and then SARA doesn't find it. But in any case, it only tells you. It doesn't assume that these mixings do exist. Because you didn't do it, you are the human, you would.
Yeah.
So, yes, so it's very easy to miss a mixing or to mix guys which actually don't mix. which in sometimes could be handy. For example, if you have two different guys, they don't mix, but you want to put them together because you don't want to have 10 different sets of particles in the final state. You say, okay, I call them all of them fermions and I put them together. Then you will get a mesh matrix which is just block diagonal. That's fine.
Yeah, that's fine, but the reverse is complicated.
But when it's when you miss something, then it could be that you really miss it. So there is this command check model that sometimes tells you, hey, you didn't introduce this mixing, why not? But it works sometimes, not always. Okay, so now let me show you the other files, which are, as I said, optional, but they are required if you want to do something else. So let's start with this. I think I prefer to start first with parameters, yes. The ones for parameters. So, like the previous file, I recommend, strongly recommend, to use the one for the standard model and only add additional parameters, okay? Because there is a lot of information which you can use from the standard model. Like the definition of G1, G2, G3. This is exactly the same coupling that you have in the standard model. You don't have to define it again. And actually, there is a very nice feature in SARA, which is that if you go to, let me show you, to this models folder, there are here two fields, two files called particles.env and parameters.env with global definitions that can be used in all models. For example, you will always have in all realistic models in the end some coupling which is G2, the gauge coupling for the SU2 left symmetry. And in that case, that coupling is already defined in this global file. When that's the case, you can use this description. So you say G2 is the left coupling, and then this left coupling is defined in that file. So you just have to know the name that is given to this coupling, and that's it. So I can show you, for example, this file. So here, left coupling. So here, when you say description left coupling, you are saying all this information because it's always like this. Okay. One more thing that you need to know is that usually the additional information that you have to give for a parameter is not that much. Let me show you some examples. Let me show you three couplings that we have in this model that we don't have in the standard model to see what we did here. So the first coupling is this, let me find it. Wiring. This is the Yukawa coupling with the M Eta left-handed doublet. Okay, this is the Yukawa coupling. And we have used three different options here. LaTeX, LeSouche, and output name. Let me tell you what this means. Output name is just the name that is gonna be used internally in SARA. So in SARA internally, this coupling will be named YN. Okay, nothing changes, but it's good to give an output name. Also, if you use SARA to create input for other codes, this is the name that will be used for that coupling in these other codes. For example, in Minecraft. Okay, output name. LaTeX is, because I told you that, you will see it later, that you can produce LaTeX output, where all the information of the model is exported into LaTeX. And SARA doesn't know that YN is Y subscript N. So you have to define how do you want this coupling to look like when it's printed in LaTeX. And then it's done here. The only thing that you need to remember is that this slash, you have to put it always twice. And this is because of some Mathematica problem. In Mathematica, slash has some meaning. So in order to avoid it, the trick is to use it twice. In LaTeX, it will appear only once. But you have to wrap it twice. But that's the only thing. If not, just YM, MN, and so on. And finally, this LeSouche is there is something called LeSouche format that some of you may know, which is, some people working with codes at some moment said, okay guys, so we have so many codes and each code uses a different input format and output format. Why don't we agree on a single unified format for our input and output? And then they came out with this LeSouche format. Okay? It's a format for providing information about the values of couplings in models. And it's made with blocks, and you will see it later. And this is called LeSouche. So here what we are doing is saying, okay, the information of this coupling will be contained in a block that will be called YN. You will see later what that means more exactly. Okay? Let me show you another example. Let me show you this VV. Here, we only have this description. Why is that? This is because VV is already a famous matrix. I mean, this is the mixing matrix for the neutrinos. And this appears in many models. So this is already in this global file that I told you before. So this VV, you don't need to specify anything else because it's already in the global file. And let me show you, for example, this lambda 5. This goes to the Pankaj question. So real, true. So this is where you say that lambda 5 is real. You give the LaTeX output, the way you want to look this, that this guy looks in LaTeX, the Lesurs block where it will be, and the entry, 6, and an output name, which is lambda 5. Also, a recommendation is that you use short names for the output names, because in some codes there is a limit. For example, in MacGraph, I think the limit is 4. So if you have more than 4 characters, you can break the... I mean, the code doesn't work. So I think it's 4, but I'm not completely sure. I also never use you know, symbols like this exclamation mark, because also this could lead to trouble. Just simple things for the output names. Okay, so this is the parameters file. So each parameter that you have in your model, you have to specify some information here. And the amount of information you want to, you specify is optional. The more information, the better. If you don't specify something, it's okay. It could only be a problem if you want to run MacGraph and things like that, and some information is missing. But in other cases, it's okay. Okay. You have also another file for the, for particles. Instead of parameters, now we will have a look at particles. Basically, the same thing. So you have here, in contrast to parameters, you have several sections, because you have particles in the gauge eigenstate section, mass eigenstate section, and there is a third section called intermediate here, Weyl fermion and intermediate, which are some intermediate states. As for the parameters, most of the options are really optional. Okay, sorry for the repetition, but they are optional. So if you don't specify the LaTeX format for something, it's okay. It will just look ugly when it prints LaTeX, but it's okay. Let me show you just a few examples. For example, for the eta fields, as I told you before, these eta fields are split into the real and imaginary part, and there is also the charge guide. So they are defined here. So for eta r, I give a PDG code, 1001. Why not? This I choose. I just have to be careful that I take a PDG code that is already taken for an existing particle. That's it. Electric charge 0, I define the LaTeX output, the output name. Also, here I say this mass Lesurs. This information is only relevant if you want to use MacGraph and Micromegas. Here what you are saying is that this mass is not going to be calculated by those programs, but read from a Lesurs input file. That's the only thing. But the rest is very intuitive. A PDG code, you just have to be careful not to pick up the same number. Electric charge, this one is charged, so I have one here. And that's it. Actually, since the very, very last version of SARA, there is a command to create templates for these files. So you implement your model, you run this command, and it creates a parameters.m template and a particles.m template, where it checks what are you missing, and then it adds these particles to and these parameters to the files. Then you just have to modify them to make sure that SARA didn't break anything. But I personally prefer to do it by hand, because unless the model is very, very, very complicated, it's just adding 3 particles, not that much. It takes 5 minutes. So that's it. Also here, let me show you this chi. I remind you what they are. This maybe I should have left open. So this chi is defined here. Okay, chi is the fermion, the Dirac spinor that is made with the singlet and the conjugate of the singlet. It's a Majorana fermion. And we have three, because we have three generations of this Majorana fermion. That's why here, when we define this chi field, we have to repeat the PDG code three times, because we have three generations. So we have to assign a different PDG code for each generation. But the rest is basically the same. The latent will be M, the output main will be M, electric charge will be zero, and we pick up the mass from a Lesuchin to 5. And that's it. There is nothing else worth mentioning. It's slightly related to, I don't know whose question, but, Panka's question, about the masses of the gauge bosons. So, one thing that you have to do for the massive gauge bosons is you have to specify where to pick up the Goldstone from. For example, here we are saying that the Z boson picks up the Goldstone from AH. And AH is what we have defined here. When we break the H0 into real and imaginary parts, it's the imaginary part. So you are saying, please take the Goldstone boson from that guy. And then automatically, Z is going to be massive. For VP, which is the photon, you don't specify that. Because there is no Goldstone for the photon.
If I'm allowed to complicate a bit this question, then in general, if you allow a wave for the eta, the second doublet also can allow that, right?
Yes.
Then there is a mixing between, then how do you define the
question? In that case, good question, very good question. In that case, if the eta gets a wave, the imaginary part of the eta mixes with the imaginary part of the Higgs doublet, right? And then you will have AH1 and AH2.
Yeah, so you have, there will be a mixing.
And then you will have, you will say here something like this. You will say, take the lightest of these guys, which is going to be massless, and this is going to be the Goldstone for the Z boson. In this case, if we only have one imaginary guy which is contributing to the Goldstone because they don't mix, you just say that one, to take it. Okay? I mean, we will see a more complicated model on Thursday, and then you will see how this is done. But basically, it's what you said. I mean, they mix. You define the mixing like you do for the fermions, and you just say, okay, take the lightest of them to be the Goldstone of this guy. And if you have more than one Goldstone, because you have more than one set and set prime, then you say AH1 is gonna be the Goldstone for this, and AH2 the Goldstone for the other. And that's it. Okay. And we are done. There are two other files. This is for the Sphino code, that I think, for the time that it is, that will be for tomorrow. And this is an example input file for a Sphino that we will see also tomorrow. But if you don't have any interest in using Sphino, you don't need any of these files. Okay, we have implemented the model. Now let's see what Sara can do for us. I mean, so far we have given information to Sara. Sara did nothing to us. We want to get something out of it. If not, I mean, this is bad business. Okay, so we loaded already Sara. Now we have to load the model. So, start scotogenic. Okay. Now it's doing some calculation. Depending on the model, this could be very fast or very slow. In this case, it was only 5 seconds. There are models which are very complicated and takes minutes. Even, I think my record is half an hour. So for very complicated models, this could be really, really slow. Because here, it calculated already all the mass matrices and vertices and so on. Okay? If the model is very complicated, it just has to repeat the same many times. In particular, I noticed that it's really slow when you have many gauge bosons. Gauge bosons, typically. Okay, so let's see, for example, how to compute mass matrices. Mass matrices is one of the first things you want to compute. For example, I want to compute the mass matrix for the chaff leptons. And this is done with this command. Mass matrix, and then in brackets, the name of the fermion. And this name has to be exactly the same name we used here, in the definition of the model. So this FE is the Dirac fermion that corresponds to the chaff leptons. So you just say, calculate it, and pop. And this is what we get. So you get V, Yukawa's, divided by square root of 2. what you expected. No? So if I make it nicer, this I will split. This is, okay? This is the mass matrix you computed. Okay? V, Yukawa divided by square root of 2. You may notice that the Yukawa is transposed. Okay? This is just because we define the Yukawa like that. But you can change the order of the fermions and then you will get the Yukawa without the transpose. Also, we get a minus sign because we put a minus sign in the Lagrangian. But you can remove the minus sign by putting a different sign. That's it. Okay, we continue. So mass matrix for the chi. I remind you again, chi is what we define as the Dirac fermion for the singlets. If I do that, I get this, which is very ugly. I mean, I get MN11, which is the Majorana mass 11, but I get here this funny combination 12 plus 21. This is because this matrix, by definition, has to be symmetric, but Sara doesn't know that. So it just, when it does the calculation, it finds that there are two contributions. So this is what you get. If you simplify this, saying, okay, if I take ij, and I is larger than I, that j, take it the other way around, you do it, and you simplify to this. This and this are the same. I'm just saying the matrix is symmetric.
Cannot you do that in the parameters?
No, this thing you cannot do. So, and this is basically this. So this is what Sara tells you, and you can simplify to this one. So far, very simple, no? Also, there are a few fields in this model that do not mix with anyone else. The scalar fields do not mix because of this set to symmetry. So you have the real part of the Higgs, the imaginary part of the Higgs, the real part of the eta, and the imaginary part of the eta. And these guys do not mix. And in this case, when you want to print on screen the mass of these guys, you have to use this type of command. So this HH is the real part of the Higgs field. And we have defined it here exactly, okay? When we split H0 into different pieces, you say that HH is the real part. And you get the mass like this. This is the expression for the mass of this guy in this model. So 3 lambda 1 d squared divided by 2 minus mh squared. This way you compute masses. If you had a very complicated model, I can tell you, I promise, this saves a lot of time. Because computing mass matrices in this model is trivial, but in a complicated model it could be really lengthy to do this calculation by hand. Tadpole equations. The Tadpole equations are basically these equations. So basically you take the derivatives of the potential with respect to the events, you put them equal to zero, and you solve them. Okay? You want to minimize the potential. This is done in SARA with this command, Tadpole equations, and then electroweak symmetry ranking. You can also choose a particular Tadpole equation, because in principle, in a model with more than one bed, you have as many equations as best, right? And then if you use the first command, you will get an array with many equations. In this case, the first equation is the Tadpole for B. This and this are exactly the same. Okay? And the second equation is zero, because we decided that the second field doesn't have a variable. So these are two ways to use the same command. And you can solve them. For example, here I will solve them using this mathematical command, solve. So I'm solving, and I get that this is the solution of the Tadpole equation. And you can choose to solve for mh squared, for lambda 1, for the best, for whatever you want. Just solving an equation. Trivial, no? And I can say, okay, use this Tadpole equation and replace it in the mass of the Higgs that we computed before. So this, and now replace the solution of the Tadpole equation. And then you get that the mass of the Higgs is finally lambda 1 d squared. So once you solve the Tadpole equation and replace them in the mass of the Higgs, you get the famous expression that the mass, the mh squared has to be this. Then you're replacing the mass of the Higgs, and you get, I think it should be here, yes. You replace, and then you get the famous expression, lambda 1 d squared. So it's good to make these checks, because otherwise you don't see if you made a mistake implementing the model. So we recover everything as expected. Okay, more complicated questions. Vertices. vertices again is a very lengthy thing if you want to compute them in a complicated model. You would have to rotate the fields here, rotate the fields there, diagonalize matrices, blah 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 blah, many things. In SARA this is done with this command. For example, in the first line I'm computing the vertex between charge lepton plus, charge lepton minus, and Higgs. Okay? And this is the result. It looks a bit ugly on the screen, but once you get used to the notation, it's not that bad. Okay? This is the... It's not working over there? This is the result. So the notation is a bit ugly, as I said. Since you have three generations for the charge leptons, this is defined here with this GT1, GT2. These are the names of the indices. So for a charge lepton bar of index GT1 and a charge lepton of index GT2 and the Higgs, this is the expression for the PL piece, and this is the expression for the P right piece. Because this coupling has a right-handed and a left-handed piece. And this, I did the translation for you into more normal terms, and it's basically this thing here. So you get I divided by square root of 2, a mixing matrix, a Yukawa, and a different mixing matrix, times PL. And this is sum over MN from 1 to 3. And you get a different expression, which is similar for the PR term. If you spend 1 minute, you will get convinced that this is exactly what Sarah calculated here. So the I divided by square root of 2 is obvious, is here. Then you have the sums over some indices from 1 to 3. And then you get this VE conjugate with some indices and so on. Okay?
Just a small question again. Sorry, if I'm asking.
No.
So if this is a three level coupling, then it should not give any off diagonal terms, right? Because you have not had any FCMCs.
Yes, so because you want to start with a diagonal Yukawa.
Even with off diagonal Yukawas, I mean, because H doesn't have any.
Yeah, this will be diagonal once you impose the structure of the mixing matrices, right? I mean, in general, this is the general expression. Mixing matrix times Yukawa times mixing matrix.
This AP is not the electron muon and tau, like the physical fermions, the physical leptons?
Yes, but...
So if they are the physical leptons, then they should not have any octagonal coupling with the Higgs, right?
That's correct. But that's because you know that. I mean, that's physics. That's not calculation. The calculation gives you this. Okay, for example, suppose the Yukawas are diagonal in the original basis. You can do that. Then, if the Yukawas are diagonal, these two matrices are diagonal as well. And then the whole thing is diagonal. But if you start with a Yukawa that is not diagonal, these two matrices will conspire to make the whole thing diagonal anyway in the end. Because what you say is correct.
Definition.
What you say is correct, but Sara doesn't know that. Exactly, okay, this is the expression. If this is the diagonal, for Sara it's magic, for you it's physics. But this is the complete expression.
But you cannot input the diagonalizing conditions for the mass matrix?
Yes, just like you did in the scalar sector, you just told them to just diagonalize this and define my J and photon.
This is what you did. I mean, this VE and UE are the matrices that you define here. This is VE and UE. So when you say I mix my left-handed charge leptons with my right-handed charge leptons, and I rotate the left-handed field with VE and the right-handed one with UE. Because in general there is a rotation, in general. Mm-hmm. If this rotation is diagonal, this is a particular basis. And then the final coupling has to be the original Yukawa times the rotation.
So can you tell Sara that choose V and U in such a way so that...
No, this you cannot. Sara will give you always the most general expression. Now you can simplify, no? You can start using Mathematica and say, okay, simplify this in this way. This you can do, but Sara will give you the most general expression. Because in this model you have that freedom. I mean, you know that there won't be any new recurrence with the diagonal terms. Yeah. But in general,
but you couldn't put a general expression for the couplings or a specific expression for the couplings in the parameter section?
You can do that, okay.
Should be possible.
This is a bit beyond what I wanted to tell you, but okay, let me tell you. in the parameters file, you can decide to use some substitutions in the analytical calculations. For example, there is this command called dependence num that is telling Sara that when you do numerical calculations, not analytical, numerical calculations, replace the Yukawa by this combination, which is already the diagonal. If you want to do that also in analytical calculations, you have to use an option which is called dependence without the num in the end. Okay? And then it will replace automatically the Yukawa by this. But still, it won't give you the expression for the mixing matrices.
Exactly.
Sara doesn't know that they are 1, 1, 1. It should. I agree with you. Okay.
No, no. Then how should you calculate the practical processes using fermions, like involving fermions?
Okay. In practical processes, you will use a numerical code. And in those things, I mean, when it's numerical, you will calculate numerically the rotation matrices that will come out as 1, 1, 1. Mm-hmm. And then numerically, you will eventually see what you're saying. But analytically, you cannot see. The problem is that Sara is done with full generality. So there is no restriction on the structure of the Yukawa, no restriction on... If you have more than one Yukawa, what you said is already false. No, if you have more than one Yukawa in a two-fixed-value model...
Still, no, no, the point is that there are redundant degrees of freedom, and we should remove that. Even if you have, even you have flavor-changing neutral current, you have some redundant degrees of freedom.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, you have always
in this model. But yeah. Not in general. In general, you may have of the diagonal terms in the, in the physical basis.
No, no. You have two Yukawa matrices in general complex, so you have 36 parameters in there. Mm-hmm. So that 36 parameters are never like physical. I mean, even when you have FCNCs, there.
Yeah, yeah. In this model. But imagine you have a two-fixed tablet model.
In two-fixed tablet model.
And then you have redundancy.
You have redundancy.
It's smaller, but you have.
Yeah, but in that case, the couplings don't have to be diagonal. They can be of diagonal in a two-fixed tablet model with two Yukawas.
I mean, the point is that in the standard model, only the chiral part you really see in the charge current. So that's what makes all the mixing, which is just in the right-handed sector, becomes not physical, because you cannot see in the charge current.
You start with a general matrix, you go to the mass basis, and the same rotation that apply to the mass matrix, you apply to the coupling. So they are diagonally in the same basis. Mm-hmm. In a two-fixed tablet model, that's not true anymore.
But the point strange is that you cannot teach the program the diagonalization conditions.
Because that's model dependent. And Sara is not that model dependent. It has to be as general as possible. So telling Sara, take this diagonal, that will be true sometimes.
This is still general. I mean, you can. So I can teach Sara. I cannot actually. Imagine that I can tell Sara that always write the coupling in the mass basis of the leptons or.
This is in the mass basis.
Yeah. So define the mass basis in a sense that the mass is diagonal. So if I want the mass of the electron, it should print me like this, me over.
Yes, but this is in the mass basis. Yeah. This is the mass basis. So you have diagonalized already because you have these mixing matrices here. This is the rotation in the left-handed sector and this is the right-handed sector. The fact that in the end this is diagonal, this is physical input. This is you need to know about the physics of the model to know that. I mean, the problem is generality. In this case, I completely agree with you that it would be nice to have this simplified without the mixing matrices and just the elements. I completely agree with you. But in a very complicated model, this won't be true anymore. And so when Sara is written, it has to be done in the most general case. So there is a compromise. Generality and simplification. And the author prefers generality. Which means that in some cases, this looks ugly just because it's the most general expression.
I have a question related to that. Can you tell in the parameters file to Sara that a matrix is unitary or something like that?
Unitary, no.
You cannot do that,
no.
Okay. Because then maybe you could use in this dependence to. You can define the Yukawa some mass matrix plus multiplied with the rotations and then everything would simplify.
Well, if you do that, you would get something like V times UE. But the Yukawa.
No, but then you define the Yukawa is the max matrix, and then the other matrix in the sides. And everything cancels, so you get the.
You can
but
do that.
Can you do that?
You can do that, Durandia.
But for that, I need to tell them that the matrix are unitary. Otherwise, they wouldn't cancel, right?
You have to give expressions to the matrices. You can do that. For example, let me show you an example. This set W is the mixing matrix in the charge gauge boson sector. And this is defined already here, this dependence, to be this famous 1 square root of 2, 1 I minus I. Yeah. So you are defining the W plus and the W minus in the standard way. That way, every time set W appears in a calculation, it's replaced automatically by this expression.
Yeah,
if you
that's
want,
numerical. I mean, you cannot do it
in
a symbolic way.
You cannot say unitary. You cannot say that. But you can say 1, 1, 1. You can give a specific expression for the matrix. But you cannot say unitary.
Okay.
There are some limitations. And the problem is always, unitary could be a general thing. Okay, but the specific expression is because of the model dependence. You want to be general.
And in this command you show us this dependence, can you have some product of other parameters previously defined?
Yes, you can say a matrix dependent depends on some parameter that I define somewhere else.
Okay.
You can do that.
I have another is it possible to like calculate the Feynman rules in different gauges, like the gauge fixing? Suppose I want a, for example, like the TB and the charge Goldstone. Okay, that coupling exists in the Feynman gauge, but
everything is done in the archive gauge.
So
it's general. So you see, I mean, the chi appears in the couplings. So you can say chi 0 or chi 1, and you choose the gauge. In this case, there is no dependence on the gauge for these couplings.
Yeah, there's physical coupling, so it's fine.
Okay. So let me show you a couple of examples more. So this is Charles-Lepton bar, neutrino, and W minus. And you get this expression. So the right-handed part is zero, and the left-handed times a gamma mu, this is a bit, you have to understand the language, this is a gamma mu PL, has this term, which is I D2 two mixing matrices divided by square root of 2. This is nothing but this thing here. So you get this global factor, these two matrices in this way, gamma mu PL. And this is nothing but the typical, this is the PMNS matrix or the leptonic mixing matrix that is the analog of the CKM. So you have rediscovered here the CKM or the PMNS with that. Because the product of these two matrices is what defines this K matrix. Okay? And you can also say, okay, I want to compute the coupling between the neutrinos, the chi, which are the singlets, and the Higgs. And you get zero. Why is that? Because this coupling is zero because of the set to symmetry. This coupling is forbidden. But if you do exactly the same, but with the eta, not with the Higgs, you get this. So you get something different from zero. So even if you try to find a coupling which is zero, it doesn't say, you're crazy. No, it just gives you a C. Okay, but you can calculate it. And this combination here is nothing but this. This thing here. So you get, as usual, Yukawa times mixing matrix, PL or PR. So these are the couplings. Okay. Now, more things. I already told you that SARA can produce LaTeX output, okay? Okay, well, before I tell you that, there is something else that you can do with SARA very easily, but it takes some time. It takes like even in a simple model, it could take half an hour. So that's why I don't do it here. Which is calculating the normalization group equations, okay? So with that, you can get things like this. You get the beta coefficient for the gauge coupling, for the scalar terms, for the Yukawas, and for all the parameters of the model. Okay, up to 2-loop level. The 1-loop level is more or less fast, it may take some time depending on the model, and the 2-loop could take hours. But in the end, you get the result. And it's saved in some files, so you don't have to run again every time. You can save them, and you just load them. You don't have to calculate them every time. Okay, and that's what I wanted to tell you. Now, let me show you how to get LaTeX output. This is done with this command maketech. Okay? But if you just run maketech, you get only some little information. It is nice to run before this model output, which basically makes some additional calculations to create some files that you don't see internally. And these files will later give you a more detailed LaTeX output. So let me run them. This takes a bit, I don't know, 1 minute or two, I don't know. Now it's calculating many vertices. If you're doing at the same time, maybe. Now it's calculating vertices. Okay, 2 vector boson, 3 vector boson, 2 Fermi, 1 scalar, 2 Fermi, it's calculating vertices like that. And when it's done, it will create this LaTeX output. And then with that we finish for today. Don't worry. Okay, so it's done. Okay, there are things that you didn't find because we decided not to calculate RGEs. But that's okay. If you calculate RGEs, the LaTeX output would also contain the RGEs written in LaTeX. But that's okay. We just decided not to do it. Okay, and in order to see the output, you have to go in SARA to the folder guest output. Okay. Output, and you have here a folder called Scotogenic that we just created, electronic symmetry breaking, and then tech. Okay, you see this folder tech. And here we have many tech files. You can open one of them and see it. It's just normal tech, like, I don't know, particle, for example. Okay, this is just normal tech that you can copy in your paper. So Sara writes paper for you. That's a nice thing. I mean, I'm not joking, eh? For appendices it's great, because all these formulas can be collected and put in an appendix. Very nicely. And you don't waste time typing, no? It's already done for you. And, okay, now you can compile this text as usual, but Florian did something for you. He created this makepdfsh. This is a file that you can execute and automatically compiles all these text files together. Okay, it's a script. So I say sh, makepdfsh. And it compiles. Now it's compiling LaTeX. It's different LaTeX. You may need maybe a package called findme or np, I don't remember now. It's written in the notes, don't worry. Findmf, because you will see that there are some Feynman diagrams in the LaTeX. So if you don't have this package, you will have to install it.
That package is available on Synaptics for the Debian family users. So it's just to write down etcetera.
Exactly, it's very easy, exactly. I think I have it written also. No? Okay, it's done. 59 pages. We just created a PDF file of 59 pages.
Oh, okay.
So it's Scotogenic, we open it to see what we have. Okay, so this is the file we just created. Okay, let's see what we have. Okay, contents. So this is what we have here. Okay, so fields, gauge fields, matter superfields, the different representations in your model. Lagrangian, well, Lagrangian, this part I don't like it. It's only some pieces of the Lagrangian. The gauge fixing terms, something like that. So let's keep it. Now, rotations in the gauge sector. So this is what we define. We say that the B and the W3 combine to the photon and the cell. Also the parametrization for these matrices with the theta weak, everything. Mass matrices, so MM is MM. We diagonalize it like this with this matrix too. I mean, all the definitions of the mass eigenstates in terms of the gauge eigenstates. The neutrinos. I get a zero here because analytically it only computes the tree level. And in this model, at tree level, they are massless. The damped quarks. The structure for the mass matrix is the Yukawa times V, 1 over square root of 2, and this delta is the color factor. Because it has to be diagonal in color. The up works, the leptons, the expression for the mass matrix for the leptons. The vacuum expectation values, or more precisely, the decomposition of the neutral fields. They are defined here. The tadpole equations. Where are the fields in the mass basis? So the names for the fields in the mass basis, the number of generations, the number of colors, whatever.
whatever the mass basis, what is H plus? What?
Sorry?
In the mass basis of field, so there's a scalar, that's the Boltzmann.
Yeah, this is that. It should not be there. This is absorbed by that, yes, you're right. Yeah. Yes, this should not be there. Anyway, you have the ghosts, which are added by automatically by Sara. And then you have a long lead with all the interactions of the model. So for example, H, A0, A0, which is the Goldstone, okay? And you get this interaction, lambda 1, V, I. Eta R, eta I, A0, wrong. And you have all the different couplings. Some of them are simpler, some of them are more complicated. For example, if we go, for example, this is to scale as one gauge boson, and here you have, this has to be derivative, this coupling, so you get the momentum of these guys. Or you have, let's go. Okay, two fermions and one gauge boson, for example. This is photon, d quark. Okay? And you can, if you do the calculation, you will see that this combination here is just the d quark charge, electric charge. Because this is the coupling to the photon. To the W plus, up quark, down quark, W plus. And you get here the structure and the coupling with the G2 and the different mixing matrices. This is the CKM. Mm-hmm. This is the CKM. The set with the different couplings and so on and so forth. So you have all the couplings in the model here.
But so there's not know about the gene mechanism.
It doesn't know much about physics. Therefore,
what are the question I ask?
Yeah, it doesn't know about things like that. But but already, I think, if it does this for you, you can do the physics. You can do the physics. Okay, so I think we can conclude here. So my plan was to continue with the Sphino, which is basically the numerical implementation of this. So this is only analytical. The next thing is to do this numerically. And since we ran out of time, we can continue tomorrow. Okay. More tomorrow. Some of you, creo que algunos tenéis que firmar o algo, ¿no? Por asistencia, puede ser. Los estudiantes de doctorado, creo. ¿No? ¿No sabéis nada?